long-term results of the DPP tell us that the effect of metformin to be beneficial in terms of preventing progression to diabetes or delaying progression to diabetes, that effect persists over the entire 15 years of follow-up, and it's looking to persist into the predictable future. In the original publication of the DPP benefit from the first 3.2 years, that's the way this study worked out, we saw that there was a beneficial effect among, a particular beneficial effect of metformin among younger folks who were more overweight. And then in a subsequent analysis, we found that there was a particularly strong beneficial effect among women who reported a prior history of gestational diabetes before they entered the study. So that was our expectation as we moved forward, was that we would see this persisting benefit, at least in those subgroups. We've done the analysis now out to 15 years, and we don't see a persisting benefit related to age or related to body mass index, obesity, but we do see a persisting benefit among women who came in with a prior history of gestational diabetes. It may not be widely known, but women who have a history of gestational diabetes have the single highest risk of progressing to overt diabetes. And so that's a group who really do warrant some form of intervention. I don't mean to minimize the effect of lifestyle, because lifestyle was also beneficial in that group and should certainly be a component of overall care. But when we look at the women who were randomized to metformin, they had an added benefit that was over and above what we could see otherwise with other therapies. So metformin is a particularly beneficial therapy among women with gestational diabetes. That should equate to, you know, use in the general population. We haven't seen a strong an uptake in general of metformin for prevention, let alone in specific subgroups. And that's what we're trying to get to with ongoing publications, is to make sure that the world knows that not only was there benefit 15 years ago, but there's persisting benefit and that there are people who have particularly strong benefit. There is a question about why we don't see strong uptake among primary care providers, general medical providers, for metformin use in prevention of type 2 diabetes. The question is why, and some of the thinking is that it's because it's officially an off-label use of the medication, and so we have been pushing an effort with the FDA to try and find some pathway to making an on-label use for prevention of diabetes for metformin, which has its own complications. For people in primary care, general medical practice, who are seeing someone with prediabetes, evidently have elevated risk of progressing to diabetes. They're overweight, it's a woman with a history of gestational diabetes, they have high glucoses or rising glucoses that are being monitored over time, and the doctor wants to do something about that. There are two main choices that have been proven. One is a lifestyle intervention, and in many places across the country, the DPP curriculum has been implemented in various ways. Sometimes it's the YMCA, sometimes it's a local version of the National Diabetes Program that's sponsored by the CDC. So there are widely available, reasonably accessible, depending on where you live largely, versions of the lifestyle intervention, and that's certainly something that should come to mind. Metformin is a perfectly reasonable alternative. The fact that it's off-label should not be a deterrent in my mind. The effectiveness persists. The effectiveness is unknown. It has a known side effect profile. So the same things that happen for folks where we start metformin in diabetes happen for folks where we start metformin in prediabetes for prevention. So we know how to manage that. And it's all a question of simply making the decision. The cost is low. The barrier should be low. The diabetes prevention program is now in the follow-up stage 3, which is happening after more than 15 years of follow-up. We're continuing to follow those people. With the first 15 years of evaluation, we know that the original large benefit of lifestyle persists over time. We know that the original benefit of metformin persists over time, and that there are persisting benefits in people who were originally randomized to one or the other group, persisting benefit with taking the medication. And so we think that there's a good argument or making an early assessment that determines somebody being at risk for diabetes and making at least one of those interventions happen.